ice that freezes during the winter is not freezing out as far as it used to. It was back then around 60s. It used to go out about maybe 20 plus miles in late 60s, and the ice used to stay there for quite a time. Now, these days, it doesn't stay that long, and the icebergs aren't that big. When the springtime comes, ice is gone. It doesn't stay as long as it used to. I recall one time my father saying the ice used to stay there to June sometime. Well, there's some icebergs out there. They used to head out to their fish camp. Nowadays, we don't see that.
Ice is deteriorating much faster. The platform is thinning, which makes it dangerous. You're not able to see it from the surface until you walk through it or traverse over it, that you find these soft spots that are created from the current underneath the ice, thawing the ice, melting the ice, which makes it very dangerous to be out on in the later part of the spring, near early summer.
The Arctic is warming at a faster rate than most of the world. Every summer, when light returns and the days lengthen, there is some ice retreat in Alaska's high Arctic. But now things are different. The entire polar ice cap is melting. In 2007, 2008, and 2009, we saw the most extreme ice retreat since the 1970s, when satellite records were first collected.
It takes multiple years to grow this multi-year ice. So if you had 10 really cold years in a row again, you could regrow that multiple year ice. But that's very unlikely. We might have one or two cold years, and then with global warming, every year it's less likely that you would have a real cold year.
We are losing so much old multi-year ice that scientists at NOAA's Pacific Marine Environmental Lab estimate the Arctic will be ice-free in summer within a matter of decades.
Conditions are not as favorable as they used to be. The ice is thin, new ice coming on. It's not the multi-year ice. It's the new ice that's formed over the season, which is much thinner. It's very unstable. It's not as heavy as the multi-year ice, which makes it susceptible for breaking off or calving right off the edge at different times. That multi-year ice is much safer to be on in comparisons to ice that's only a couple feet thick to something that's 3, 4, 5 feet thick. You know, that's where the differences that we're dealing with nowadays.
A combination of factors made this happen in the high Arctic.
Basically, what we had was a perfect storm. The weather was really unusual, with a lot of winds from the south for many years in the last 10 years. And so that carried more heat north. So when you had that extra heat from just random weather combined with a global warming signal, that was enough to melt a lot of the ice in the summer. And once you melt that ice in the summer, it changes from being white and reflective to a dark ocean surface. The solar heat goes into the ocean rather than reflecting out, and so that heat then is stored there in the ocean, and then in the fall it's given back to the atmosphere.
The Bering Sea is also changing. But interpreting scientific and local observations year to year is difficult.
I'm doing a lot of interactions with ecosystem and supplying the base of the ecosystem, which is the physical and chemical type information, to try and understand how that influences the ecosystems and how the ecosystem responds to different changes in climate, to changes in simple physical forcing, to changes in a variety of those type of things.
The Bering Sea is a perfect example of this climate variability where you can have warm periods and cold periods. The main reason is the Bering Sea is the transition ground between really cold, dry air in the Arctic and real moist, warm air from the Pacific Ocean. And so the boundary of those can really shift back and forth and have a big effect when it shifts one way or another. The Bering Sea, the ice there is influenced by the winter, and it will still have these large natural variability of warm periods and cold periods, and it's affected by the Pacific Ocean as well as the Arctic.
The Bering Sea is an ice-dominated system in the winter, and sometime in the late fall, usually November, you begin to form sea ice in the north. And as the year progresses, it becomes very cold. The wind blows out of the north. It will always form it in the north. It blows the ice southward. To know where the ice edge is very important. And the best way to tell that is with satellites.
On the face of it, if you look at the satellite images, there is more area covered by ice than there was last year. But that's a very two-dimensional view. The key is the thickness of the ice, which in the end tells you how much is out there. What's happening as a result of the north winds is that the ice that's forming farther north is drifting south in response to the winds, so some newer, thinner ice forms in the area that was just evacuated. That ice is thin enough that it's going to melt out relatively easily when the spring warming begins in March and April. So it's a very fragile and deceptively extensive ice cover. The ice volume is not what it appears to be. It's thinner ice covering a larger area.
Sea ice comes in a myriad of forms.
We went out boating.
There are 99 words in the St. Lawrence Yupik language that describe sea ice conditions. For the Yupik and Inupiaq peoples, reading the ice conditions is a matter of survival.
The ice condition as of today versus back then is a lot thinner now. We do get ice out, right? But because of the thickness of the ice versus back then, it doesn't stay there long enough. It does have effect on safety going out during springtime and when it starts to melt.
We
used to harvest walrus during springtime and during fall, and it's been about 3-4 years now. No one in the village has harvested those because the ice breaks, they move with the ice.
At Koyuk, freeze up starts around September, October, and then May and maybe first part of June. But we're seeing a lot less of the ice, and the thickness of the ice has changed, and the movement of ice on the ocean is a lot more than it doesn't stay stable anymore as much as it used to. Now there's a lot of times when the bay is open. As years go, we see different changes and we adapt to them. We've seen a lot of difference in the ice thickness. The time as a little boy, it changed to where we've seen rain in November and odd things that are not normal at the time when I was growing up.
Loss of shore-fast ice has exposed the coast to storm surges and rapid erosion. Houses are falling into the sea. People are preparing to move their villages to new locations.
Native peoples have always been resilient in the things that are made available to them. Although these times and changes are harder and more profound, and it's difficult to really understand how we're going to deal with it, never having gone through this. We've gone through great deaths through epidemics and others, but not through weather.
The changes going on in the Arctic are really scary how fast they're happening. The loss of sea ice, the warmer temperatures, the impact it's already having on polar bears, seals, and worms and clams as well is already a major change. Changes I didn't think I would see in my lifetime.
Knowing the the resiliency of our people and the ability to adapt to the environment around them. I think it will be very difficult. I feel that it will be, but being as resilient as we are, I believe we'll be able to survive.
I am a Kotuk.